Ambrosia.
Hi.
Really excited to be here with you. I'm here with Ambrosia Vertesi, the VP of Talent from Hootsuite. I've been really looking forward to this all conference. Why don't you tell me a little bit about yourself?
First of all, I'm happy to be here. I know we're in day two of the conference, but I have, you know, been in people practitioner in some sense for a long time, and I kind of think of it like a lot of people do in terms of just iterating on your career. But I first started out as a teacher before I was anything. And that was, you know, a really amazing look into what does it look like when there's infrastructure for learning and you're creating a learning environment. And then thinking, how can I apply that into organizations? So I worked in video games for a while. I worked in fashion for a while. I came back to tech to head up the operations function at Hootsuite, but then the organization and the talent function. And so that's where I'm spending a significant amount of my time and just having a tremendous amount of fun.
Excellent. Tell me a little bit about Hootsuite.
Hootsuite is really at the cusp of the social revolution is what they're calling it, but it is completely focused on helping people work through and optimize how to integrate social into their organizations. So if social is disrupting the way that we communicate for not just businesses, but also for just people in general in their everyday lives, then we have a freemium model that really tries to solve those problems for everybody and build a one-source aggregate dashboard for people to be able to go to all of their places for months. And then as their needs complicate, then we build a solution to help support that.
Excellent. Yeah. So I know you do a lot of speaking and thought leadership on the topic of social HR. Yeah. Explain to me, what is social HR?
Yeah, it's a thing that I've kind of spoken a few times about, saying my goal is to create no social HR, because I really believe that it's just HR, and it's just a different tool that we use, just like we don't talk about our digital HR strategy or real life HR strategy. But right now I think it's a value to call it social HR, because it really does permeate every aspect of our functions. I mean, it starts usually with recruiting, and then it moves into, okay, now I've brought in that person through social. How do I continue that value proposition, especially in a workforce where it's highly millennial, ever-growing millennial, and they see it as a table stake of their everyday. They don't see it as, you know, something that they might be able to do if they get a job. They see it as, how are you going to enable me with this?
Right.
And for multi-generational workplaces, it's, how are you going to educate me about this? Mm-hmm. And so we really do need a strategy because it's everywhere. It's permeated. And it's internal comms, and it's HR, and it's corporate social responsibility, and a lot of different things. So right now, I think the focus is holistic strategies and then building, you know, specializations and best practices within each one of those, and then helping each other figure it out. Yeah.
So what role do you think HR plays in bringing social inside the enterprise?
I think that, you know, I heard a funny quote earlier today, which probably says it about right, is that if there isn't a functional head, it's HR's job, right? And
that's good.
You know, they're a catch-all because it doesn't matter what industry size, sector, or where you're at in your business, but we're all an intellectual capital business. Mm-hmm. We all have people at the helm who make or break our business. And so for us, it's right now, we're either seeing two entry points into the organization, either through marketing or through HR, through recruiting. And the emerging one now actually is customer service. Mm-hmm. So if our customers are on social media increasingly, no matter what your sector, and then you expect your employees to be able to support those customers, well, then they better be socially educated, because that's where they're going to find their people. So those are kind of the entry points that come into the business. And then they kind of look to HR to go, well, can you get everybody up to speed on this? And can we come up with a strategy? And can you make sure that it's, you know, supporting our customers, aligned to our customer journey? Can you make sure that they, you know, are helping us be brand advocates? And can you make sure they don't mess up and we don't end up with some PR disaster that we've all read about? And so that's a pretty big challenge for a function that already has a lot on its plate. Yeah. And I think that aligned with, you know, some of the stuff that, you know, HR technology is kind of facing, and you know, really moving into the marketing and IT space, HR is kind of spanning itself a little bit. And then it still has all its bread and butter things to do. So social HR really right now is about how do we, you know, get the HR practitioners and the people aligned on being successful on their journey together.
Yeah. And what does success look like to you? There are a lot of organizations still have a lot of fear around social and a lot of confusion around what a social HR strategy looks like, where to begin, how to drive adoption, how to protect yourself from some of those risks that are inherent in social.
Yeah, I think that's very real. And 4 years ago when I was, you know, lucky enough to go around the world and talk to HR practitioners, the conversation was very much so, how do I protect myself? Mm-hmm. It was, that's really nice. You know, I would talk about why you should do social HR, and then, you know, people would be like, that's so great. Can you just give me the social policy so that I, you know, it was very compliance centric, very security centric, which is very real. Like, you have to have, we're all highly regulated. Mm-hmm. We have to make sure we're protecting our brand and our people and our organization. That's our job. But that was where it showed up a lot. Unless it was a very early adopting organization, it showed up in protection. And then about 2 years ago, it kind of started in enablement, and then it became brand ambassadors and, okay, recruitment, all of these kinds of things, and they started getting it. But then it became, okay, I get the why, but I still want the policy, and I still want to know how to protect ourselves, but then I need to know how to really empower and educate our employees and so I can affect the bottom line. And that became a very different conversation, and where we said people needed to start was education. Mm-hmm. If we're banking on the fact that social is a competency, which we are, that as well as collaboration and change management, then you need to start by educating people. What does that actually mean to you? Because social to some people means sharing their lunch and, you know, connecting with their family and friends. Social doesn't mean enabling their business. And you have to decide as an organization, why are you using social? Do you want to hire people? Do you want it only to hire people? Do you want it to connect with your customers? Or do you want to actually create an army of brand ambassadors, and your value proposition is you expect your employees to help you do that? You need to set that very clearly, because that becomes part of how you're going to engage with your employees. If your employees are not understanding why you're using it, or they're not understanding that where they play in that role, then you're not going to get adoption. And you're not going to get amplification. And it doesn't matter what tool you use, to be honest with you, at that point, because they don't get it. And so you have to simplify it for them, and then tell them, you know, educate them about what social media is, and then why you're using it. And then it starts to align, okay, well, what are the best strategies for us if we're trying to hire 100 people, we're a globalizing organization, and we want to connect better with our customers on a 24-hour-a-day real-time response? If those are the three things you're trying to achieve and you think social can contribute to that, give people the education on how it can contribute to that, then put in the tools and the resources and the timelines on what that's going to look like, then you can talk about activation. But it's a lot of like front loading.
And that's very helpful. I think a lot of times organizations simply jump beyond the what problem are we solving, and sort of jump onto the social bandwagon without being really clear. So specific to Hootsuite, what problems does social solve for the HR function at Hootsuite?
We're trying to be the best use case of a social organization, not just, you know, selling our product, but actually educating people. And so one of the ways that we do that is we try to eat our own dog food with our product. So we use it, obviously, for recruitment. I think that's the easy sell for people. We have a content library that allows us to store employer branding materials, localized materials. And then we use it for onboarding as well. So we recently iterated on our education offering to support with onboarding of employees and learning and development of employees in social. So if we say social is a competency, then what are we doing to help people with that as an organization? So last week, or no, the week before, we launched a product called Podium. And Podium sits outside of the Hootsuite dashboard, but is very much part of the umbrella. And what we did was we took social education outside of tool training, and we made it free. And so it's a completely certified course. We've spent the last 4 years punching holes through it ourselves to make sure that HR practitioners and employees would care about it, and then partnered with universities and specialists to say, is this a value to people? Are these the skills people need? And we put it outside of the paywall. And that for us was a way to say, you know, we're gonna onboard our employees to this. That's how much we care about it. And we have a very high bar for what social competency means. We expect our employees to use it every single day to do their job. So if we endorse it, then there should be some value in there, hopefully, between all those peer reviews.
That's fantastic.
And that was a way to say, if you want tool training, we've got solutions for that, and we can help you do that. But a lot of times we were going into organizations and finding that it wasn't the tool, it was the idea of social and the fear behind it. And our employees were no different. When we were onboarding employees, we've grown from 20 to 1,000 people in less than 4 years in 10 countries. We had to build social competency as well. And then what we use Podium as is, as we mature, we build it into our learning and development so that there's continuous learning. And that way we're able to enable people to support whatever the initiative is we're working on, because we don't use every social network. Not every social network is helping us, you know, with what we're trying to do. But we're focusing on hiring, we're focusing on employer branding, of course, we're focusing on onboarding, because when you're hyper growing, onboarding is imperative to success. We're focused on also providing L&D with some opportunities and some free resources that they can utilize. Their budgets are always strapped. And then we've also started integrating it into performance management with different gamifications, and we're looking at integrations. We have over 100 integrations with Hootsuite that service, you know, whatever the challenges or the tool you're using. And so we've been looking at different ways through our performance management system, which requires its own overhaul, of course, all of them do.
As everyone does.
As everybody does, and I'm sure a lot of people here at the conference are trying to find solutions for. We're redefining what we want to utilize that for, and then we're going to be seeking a way to make sure it's social and transparent, either through, you know, recognition is probably an easy way to integrate that in. And then we'll be integrating with somebody who's already solving that problem, but we'll be looking to make it social.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
So there's been a huge amount of talk about the future of work in the press over the last few years. And we all talk about the, you know, coming 2020 and what the workforce is going to be look like and how 50% of the workforce will be millennials. My guess is the future of work is probably already here at Hootsuite. A big conjecture, but I'd love just to get your reaction to that, and if in fact that's the case, and what does that mean and what does that look like?
Yeah, I mean, I hope that we're trying, you know, just like anybody, but we are 70% millennial, which means that we're going to have a very strong appetite for the future workforce, both preparing for it and it being on our lap right now. You know, we're faced with it already. And for us, that looks like a couple things. So mentioning collaboration, and you're seeing a lot of technologies try and support that. And I think we're seeing a lot of organizations that we partner with, and what we're trying to model is really thinking about the life cycle and the user experience. And I mean, not to be too HR tech nerdy about it, but just like you would think about your customer experience if they were going through your product, we're thinking about, those are our customers. My employees are my customers. I'm here to partner with them. I'm here to build with them. I'm here to remove roadblocks for them. I'm here to enable them to be successful. Those are very similar to what you hear in go-to-market conversations. And so that partnership with this new workforce, collaboration is required. Tools that support collaboration is required. Integration is required. So a seamless, you know, whether it's mobile first, whether it's integrated products, so your HRIS talking, your ATS talking to, you know, your payroll system, so that people don't have high administration is really important. And then flexibility. So how do you create benefits programs that are a la carte, that people can customize without completely, you know, draining your bank accounts in an effort to appease? And so that for us are some of the things we're solving. And then, you know, social can't solve the benefits problem right now, but maybe one day it will, when we put in, you know, real-time data into, is it working for you? You see a lot of employee engagement surveys that are moving into this real-time environment. I mean, they're started moving into weekly, but we aim to be real-time. We find that we expect our employees to solve customer problems in real-time. People won't wait 2 weeks for an answer. In recruitment, people expect, you know, an answer pretty instantly. How can we build frameworks that support that in a way that's efficient for our business or any business? And then how do we, you know, have our employees, like, work with them to share with them the stuff we can't do? You know, we're not going to be able to do everything.
Yeah, that's great. So one of the themes that I've picked up on over the past couple of days at the conference,
yeah,
is this whole dissolution of the traditional organizational hierarchy and the rise of the teams, yeah, and the network and how work is getting done in a much more dynamic and flexible way, yeah, cross-functional, matrixed, sort of self-forming teams. Yeah. Love to hear how work gets done at Hootsuite, and yeah, are you seeing the rise of different types of organizational models and structures in the way that work gets done?
Yeah, this is a big topic for us as we're, you know, hyperscaling, globalizing, it's right at kind of tip of tongue. And two ways we're trying to tackle that, one being the collaborative nature of being like, we're all in this together, and this is how we're going to form a strike force, mm-hmm, or agile work methodologies. We're looking at, you know, what are organizations doing that are testing this out. I mean, you see what Zappos is doing. That's really far, yeah, on that spectrum, but it's exciting. And then there's other organizations that are just removing hierarchy roadblocks and things like that. And so some of the things that we brought into the organization that we think add value to this idea of collaboration, mm-hmm, is working out loud. Mm-hmm. And working out loud is the easiest way for us as both leaders, individual contributors, new employees, people that we want to hire, to kind of see how. Mm-hmm. How are you doing that? And to rise, you know, the tide collectively, so that we're able to not only share the outcome, mm-hmm, but share the process at which it got there, and people can take that learning away. So we've recently introduced Facebook at Work. Mm-hmm. We were one of the first companies to beta with them, and them being a strategic partner for us, obviously, in the social world, we were more than happy to partner with them, but we were already using Yammer as an internal collaboration, mm-hmm, tool. And what we liked about Facebook was that there was no requirement for change of behavior or workflow. Mm-hmm. I didn't have to, you know, have one resource dedicated to a rollout internally for 6 months to see if people cared. You know, it was immediately, if you know how to use Facebook, you know how to use Facebook at Work. And what was great about that was that people were already logging into Facebook. So yep, clicking a button to go into Facebook at Work, I wasn't trying to get them on the internal collaboration tool, because that's half the battle. You should collaborate. Go on this tool to collaborate. Too many steps already.
Right.
So go where they are if you want to change their behavior, and mm-hmm, then just see if the ask is a bit. So we can see our self-evolved groups, creating a group, an open group, and sharing the ones that have signed up to help us with things like operational efficiencies, people who are new, who are onboarding and see the dialogue there. Being able to watch them work through the problems or the solutions gives everybody the collective knowledge. It helps with buy-in. Mm-hmm. And it also helps us with L&D on being able to say, okay, through that working process, we saw that, you know, this individual might need some support on negotiation skills. Mm-hmm. And this individual has a tendency to, you know, not let any ideas get through. They're not actually collaborating. Mm-hmm. Or this person was just, you know, very quick to call out the problems but had no solutions. Mm-hmm. We can see that without, you know, myself being in an hour meeting where somebody's put together a deck to posture an outcome. Mm-hmm. What a great relationship to build real-time solutions and iterative solutions to your practices.
Yeah. That's fantastic, and I love the term. Yeah. I love the term working out loud. That's terrific. So HROS, yeah, I think a really exciting mission that you're on. Tell me, yeah, a little bit about that.
So probably building off the idea of working out loud, mm-hmm, and one of the things I'm really grateful for at Hootsuite is that we're provided an opportunity to take risks. And we want our employees to take risks. In order to be at the forefront of an emerging technology, you have to be risk-taking and you have to innovate. And how do you incent that as you grow is a really serious problem for people, because the risks you're taking have bigger consequences when you're a 20-person team. You've got this underdog mentality. How do you keep that underdog mentality? And so sharing our learning, working out loud, building it's okay to take risks, and educating and empowering people that's something that we welcome. I mean, mm-hmm, I don't want you to take risks on our paying an invoice or something, but
right,
like there are safe places, there, mm-hmm, are sandboxes that you can create no matter your size. And we've done this with lots of organizations to say, I don't know, figure it out. I don't know. Let's see. Just try it. Let's try and see what happens. And so the idea of working out loud, some of the learnings we took from that, I was empowered by my CEO to say, hey, HR is a function. I mean, they don't really often aren't empowered to share their mistakes. Mm-hmm. We have to be impenetrable. We have to, you know, always get it right. We have to manage risk. But we're all human, and we're all evolving with this. And so a lot of the stuff we learned at Hootsuite, we were able to build and change as we went through. And I thought those would be valuable learnings for people. But also, leading by example and leading with humility are two of our values. And so leading with humility means getting to, you know, open the kimono and say, we tried this. If you're going to try this, here's, you know, not the HR marketing about why you should do it and how amazing it was. And here's the how. Here are the lessons we learned. Here's a case study about the things we didn't get right that you could maybe learn from. And here's the template. Go do it. That is not competitive intelligence to me. Competitive intelligence was the, you know, stuff that's proprietary or the stuff that worked for Hootsuite specifically. Yeah. But best practices, you know, we have to create an environment of shared learning in HR. And we have to empower our leaders who, if we want HR to take risks and we want them to support this new business, you have to let them take their previous learnings, show their vulnerability in the builds that they're making, and then, you know, that humanizes them to their employees. It removes all the black holes. And then they're building together. And then it isn't we as HR giving this to you or making you do this. It's we're all going to try this and we're going to see if it works.
Yeah.
And so HROS was housed within Hootsuite. We did 5 case studies in 4 months that we shared openly, everything from here's how we measure recruitment conversion and here's a handy report that you can build that's free. Mm-hmm. Here's our employee branding guidelines. A lot of people are looking and paying a lot of money to get employer branding guidelines. Mm-hmm. So this was our shot at it.
Yep.
You know, we're looking at things like corporate social responsibility. And then we opened it up and put out an advocacy to share it at Talent Connect a few weeks ago, saying we dare other organizations to do this too. Mm. Why don't we create a movement for our function where we all grow together and we all open up, you know, with the ability of, and the only intention of being, of sharing. And that sparked quite a movement that we were unprepared for. This is not a, you know, this is brand agnostic now. It's now mm-hmm. HROS. Hootsuite is supportive of it, but it's a volunteer initiative. And we had 150 organizations respond, signing up to share their learnings openly with the community. And these are everything from a 10-person marketing agency, but we've got Spotify, we have Oracle, we have Whole Foods just signed up, we have Earl's restaurants signing up. These are enormous organizations that have put themselves forward and said, we need to do this and we shouldn't be fired for sharing our learning.
So if there's anyone, any of the viewers who are interested in joining, how would they get in touch?
Very simply, 2 ways that you can get involved. If you want to learn more, you can go to HROS.co.
Okay.
So HROS.co, because it's actually very hard to find handles and websites these days. And then very simply, the hashtag HROS. Okay. And so they can follow the dialogue there. There's lots of leaders. We have 500 leaders that are starting a conversation there. And people are asking simple things. Do you do background checks? Should I be doing background checks? Does anybody know somebody who does this?
Yeah.
Or we just launched a recruiting campaign and it did not work. Mm-hmm. Help.
Yeah.
It's just that simple that we should just be helping each other, not in silos and not in safe places, but at conferences like this where we learn what we should be doing, why we should be doing it. People should be walking away with tangible resources mm-hmm. that they can apply practically to see if it works for them, or looking at it and saying, that's not for me, and now I don't have to worry about it.
Right. Yep. I want to wrap up with a huge thank you from the industry, because that is absolutely a huge service that you're doing for the HR profession.
Thank
so
you.
Personally, as someone who's been in this profession for over 20 years, I'm thrilled about it, and it's just been a pleasure talking with you.
Thank you.
Thank you
as well.
So much, Ambrosia.
Thank you.
Thank you.